Good evening, family and friends, and welcome to our Wednesday night Bible study. It is such an honor to be here with you before you this evening as we wait for others to join us. Just want to welcome everybody and thank you for your presence. Our lesson is a good lesson on tonight. Bias love, coming out of the book of Genesis, the 37th chapter. Our scripture is Genesis 37, 2 through 11, 23 and 24a, and verse 28. So if we could just bow for a word of prayer, we will move forward as the Lord leads us. Father God, we thank you for another beautiful day. We thank you for life, for health, for strength. We thank you for your word being made flesh and being with us, God. We thank you for the opportunity to reason one with another and seek the Holy Spirit in rightly dividing your word of truth, God. We ask that you would anoint us afresh, anoint our ears to hear, anoint our hearts that we might feel what the Spirit has to say to us tonight. Bless us as only you can. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So, bias love. Our key verse for today is, his brethren envied him, but his father observed the same. His brother envied him, but his father observe the same. When I think about that verse, it reminds me of when Mary, the mother of Jesus, heard that she was going to be carrying him, that she pondered those things in her heart. And I often wondered if it was the same sense that Jacob was observing what Joseph's dreams were and just thinking about them. Whereas his brothers were envious of the dream, Jacob contemplated the dreams and what the real meaning, what God was speaking to his son. So biased love. By way of intro, I just want to begin. The struggle with love surrounding Joseph's family is complicated, to say the least, and goes back to the beginning with his great-grandfather Abraham through Isaac past Jacob to get to Joseph. If you will allow me tonight, I'd like to step out of the box, step out of the shallow end of the pool, and dive into the deep end. Because as we look at Joseph and his ancestors, we can see some parallels that will take us through a family history that I believe deals with trauma. Deals with trauma. So the first part is a family discord. Friction, favoritism, and fury. Friction, favoritism, and fury. More than 25% of American youth experience a serious traumatic event by their 15th, 16th birthday. Many multiple and repeated traumas for some of them. Can you think of at least one event in Joseph's life that might be considered a traumatic event? Can you think of at least one event in Joseph's life that might be considered a traumatic event? First, he was hated by his brothers. We know he was hated by his brothers because of he was favored by his father. But we know because of his dreams that he was hated by his brothers. But after he had additional dreams and shared those dreams with his brothers, the hatred grew to envy, and the envy grew to something far worse that we will look at a little later. So he was hated by his brothers, 10 brothers. Joseph was the 11th of 12 sons. At this point, Benjamin had been born, but Benjamin was a very young child. So he was the 11th of 12 brothers born and one sister. So he had 12 siblings. He was verbally abused and physically abused as well. He was verbally abused. The scripture says that they could not even speak peaceably with him. So when they would try to have a conversation with him, they couldn't even talk to him in a peaceable manner. They couldn't listen to him or hear what he had to say. They wouldn't even give him the opportunity, I can imagine, to share what he was experiencing. And with him being, if you think about the fact that Joseph is the 10th, the 11th of 12 boys, there are 10 boys older than Joseph. And at this point in Joseph's life, in our scripture verse, he is 17 years old. So if there's 10 boys older than him, then some of them are young men. Some of them are young men, they're not boys. As a matter of fact, if Joseph is 17, he's considered a young man himself and not a small boy or child or youth. So that's interesting in and of itself. They caught him and stripped him of his nice coat that his father had made for him. They plotted to kill him and decided to sell him. So those events, those are three events that I believe were very traumatic for Joseph, that his brothers had developed such a disdain for him that they couldn't even talk to him, that he maybe was a loner because all of his other brothers felt so bad about spending time with him, and his other brother was such a young child. So when they saw him and plotted to kill him, his oldest brother, though, Reuben, said, "No, let's not kill him. Let's just throw him in a pit." And when they decided to throw him in the pit, Reuben left. After Reuben left, the other boys decided, they saw a caravan, the scripture says, and they decided to sell him. So they sold him for silver. They had taken his coat, so they were physical with him. So he was caught, stripped of his coat, and then he was thrown in a pit, pulled out of a pit, and sold into slavery. But prior to being sold, he heard their plan to kill him. He also heard Reuben's plan to say, "Let's not do this to him. Let's not kill him ourselves. Let's just leave him in this pit and he will die of his own. He will die of natural causes, or we won't know what became of him, but that he will be no more." And I'm sure when you think of trauma, you think of Joseph and what's going through his mind, what's going in his heart, what is he thinking, wondering if he's hopeful that at least one of his brothers is possibly willing to spare his life and can talk to his other brothers about allowing him to stay and not destroy his life or sell him into slavery, which Reuben was not privy to. So do you think that he had hope after hearing Reuben's discussion with the other brothers? Do you think that that gave Joseph a glimmer of hope as he was down in that pit thinking about the possibility of his oldest brother rescuing him from the others? I'm sure that it was not only just traumatic for Joseph, but it could have also been traumatic for the other siblings as well. So on the fourth thing, he had to live with the fact that he didn't get to say goodbye to his father. He didn't get to say goodbye to his brother Benjamin. So when they took him, his father had sent him to them, and when they took him and took his coat and stripped him and put him in a pit and then sold him, he was away from home. So he was 17 years old, away from home, sold into slavery, and never got a chance to see his father or his brother again. That could be considered a great traumatic experience for him that was ongoing, that lasted for a number of years. Joseph was 17 years old when his brother sold him. That would make his brother Benjamin only about 2 to 3 years old. And Joseph was 30 years old when he was reunited with his family. If you recall, he asked his brothers if his father was still living. And he asked them that when they returned, when they came down to Egypt to buy grain because of the famine, he asked them when they returned to bring, as a matter of fact, he requested, he demanded that if they returned to buy grain again, that they definitely had to bring his brother Benjamin with them, or he would not see them. He would not, they would not see him. So they would not be able to buy grain to help their family if they didn't bring Benjamin with them when they came. So his desire to see his brother was great. His desire for the one brother that was his full blood brother, because there was four women that had the 12 boys. It was four different women. And so his mother, unfortunately, the greatest of the traumatic events was her passing. Joseph's mother passed away giving birth to his baby brother Benjamin. So could you imagine Joseph waiting and wondering how long he was going to have to wait, or if in fact they were going to come back? He knew that there was a famine. He knew that the famine was going to be long. He knew that they were already out of grain and that they would probably run out of grain again, but he didn't know how long because he loved them so much that he blessed them in giving them extra grain in their bags to take back with them and the money that they came to buy the grain with. So he blessed them and put more in their extra in their sacks. And when they return. So as traumatic as everything that Joseph has already gone through, you can think of Joseph prior to being sold into slavery. It is believed that he was about 14 to 16 years old when his mother died. So he was a young teen when his mother passed away. And we know that Jacob loved Joseph more than all of his 12 children. We know that Jacob made him a beautiful coat that none of the other siblings had. Have you ever wondered why Jacob would do such a thing? Could it be that it was a gift to try to console his son? Could it be that at the time Jacob made the coat was after the time his mother had passed, and that a father was trying to help his son to grieve, to come out of it, to understand, to help him, to cheer him up so that he would not be so sad? Might that make a difference? If you knew that, if that was a fact, might that make a difference in your perception of Jacob and his treatment towards Joseph? Might that make a difference in understanding him and his relationship with his brothers? To know that the brothers was jealous that he made the coat. But the reason that he made the coat may have helped them to understand why their father did it, if their father had the opportunity or was willing or did share with them the reasoning behind why he gave Joseph such an elaborate gift. To what extent would you go through to console your child? Have you ever done something that wasn't about favoritism, but that your children looked at it as being favorite, showing favoritism towards one of their siblings? Children, sometimes you think the oldest gets more, is more favored, and then you think the baby is more favored. So if there's more than two children, then there's a middle child. And if you're not the oldest or you're not the baby, sometimes you fall in the gap. So maybe it, when you look over your life and your family dynamic now, you may find where you fit in one of those molds. And you may be able to look back at your family now and say, you know, this wasn't fair, and this wasn't fair, and this wasn't fair. And now, as we grow older, we're able to talk one with another about it. And we often hear that mom liked, favored this child better, and dad favored this child better, and the middle child was left out, and things, situations like that. And sometimes there are very hard feelings even on into adulthood, even on into our older years, we still hold some resentment. Sometimes you still hear situations where families are still going through situations because of their parents' interaction with some of the kids versus some of the other kids. Children are more vulnerable to trauma because of their size, their age, and their dependency. Joseph no longer had the one person he possibly relied on to help him with the ins and outs of dealing with his brothers. There's nothing like a mother's love. And because Rachel, his mother, couldn't have children for so long, I'm sure that she loved Joseph so much as being able to get pregnant and have Joseph, that I'm sure she was his protector and his defender and all of that with his older brothers. And I'm sure that at some point, I can imagine that even though Jacob loved Joseph so much, I can imagine that there was some times when Jacob probably said some situations was just boys being boys. So boys will be boys. Boys play. Boys are rough sometimes, rough housing and horse playing. But boys also take it too far sometimes and end up bullying younger brothers. And seems like at this point, the bullying has escalated into something even worse. And now there has been violence as a result of the bullying. So I'm sure there was ultimately where Joseph and his brothers had issues where mothers were having to defend their children, their siblings. When you think about the family dynamic where Jacob had two wives, and each of his wives had two nurses, which also had children for him. And think of one thing that comes to mind is that he had one daughter. And it's interesting to me that the daughter wouldn't be the favorite, because there's 12 boys, but there's one girl. And it's also interesting to me that the daughter was born around the exact same time that Joseph was born. So they were about the same age. Dinah was her name. And that means that when God finally opened Rachel's womb so that she could get pregnant, not only was Rachel pregnant, but Leah was also pregnant. Her sister, Leah, was also pregnant. And so Leah gave birth to Dinah prior to Rachel giving birth to Joseph, but right about the same time. So they were right at the same age. So let's look back at the family for a minute. When Rachel was finally able to get pregnant, she, like I said, gave birth to Joseph while Leah was pregnant and also had given birth to Jacob's only daughter. And it seems like that would have been daddy's little girl. It seems like with 10 boys already, here comes a girl, that the girl is going to be the favorite. And it may have ended up being so if Rachel never would have been able to get pregnant and give birth to Joseph and then Benjamin. Jacob was also raised in a home that showed favoritism, when the Bible says that his father Isaac loved Esau and Rebekah loved Jacob. So I think that the question is it possible that Rebekah decided to favor Jacob because she saw that his father favored his brother? So think about that for a second. If you have two kids and you see that one parent is showing extra love, extra support, extra, you know, care for one child, and it seems like the other child is left out, sometimes maybe the other parent will try to pick up the slack with the other child and say, okay, well, I'm going to show, since Jacob loves Esau so much, since Isaac loves Esau so much, I'm going to show Jacob some extra love. And the Bible says that his mother loved him more. They were twins. Esau and Jacob were twins, but they weren't identical twins. And the Bible says that Esau was a red, ruddy, hairy man, and he was a hunter. And that his father liked to eat from the game that he brought home. So that's one reason why his father loved him more. But that could have created trauma with Jacob. It could have created trauma between the boys, because we know that they had certain instances in their lives where they really didn't have the meeting of the minds together, and they kind of battled with one another more than on one occasion. So can you think of any traumatic events in Isaac's story? In Isaac's story. Because sometimes you have to look at a family history. Sometimes there's a family history that lets you know that, okay, so Joseph has trauma, so Joseph may have developed a mental illness or PTSD or something that caused him to have symptoms of trauma and show. But if you look back in the history, you could say Jacob also experienced a lot of trauma. And what kind of trauma Jacob experienced, favoritism, he then perpetuated on his children. And then so you look at it, so Joseph did and Jacob did. So now Isaac, and when you think about Isaac, you're going back through the family line of his ancestry and saying, I can think of one great event that I think would be very traumatic for Isaac. And that was when his father took him and bound him and laid him on an altar to sacrifice him. I can also think that not only was that a traumatic event for Isaac, but it also could have been a traumatic event for Abraham as well, even though he was the perpetrator at the time. He was the one that was doing it to his son. God asked him to do it. So he was trying to prove himself faithful to God, but can you imagine having to do something that your child would view as traumatic? Can you imagine hearing your child asking you questions, trying to figure out what's going on. Why would you do this to me? Why is this happening? And the trauma that it would cause. Can you imagine that even after Isaac was released by Abraham and a ram was found in a thicket and killed on his behalf, that may have went through Isaac's head a number of times, trying to reason that out? Can you imagine that the story could have been passed on between the generations about this happened between my dad did this, or my father did this, or I remember the time when me and my brother did this? And so it looks like there has been a series of traumatic events passed down from generation to generation, and it has continued. And when you think about back at Joseph's point, Joseph is now in Egypt, and he has waited a long time for his family to come. And once he sees his family, he's fulfilling the very dreams that God has said he would fulfill. So he had these dreams, and he said that in his dreams that he had, and told his brothers that they would, he saw them bowing down to him. And indeed, they ended up bowing down to him. So his dreams came true. His dreams came true. Not only was Joseph a dreamer, but Joseph also could interpret dreams. And so that's how he got to the point where he would be in Egypt and able to bless his family. So God was dealing with Joseph. And sometimes you think things are going to work out one way, but it's not the way that God has intended for things to work out. But it doesn't mean that it won't work out. And God says that all things work together for good. So it may not look like a good course of action to get Joseph to where he had to get to. It was the course of action, and it did work together for the good of the entire family. I want to talk about the mothers for a second, because if you think about Rachel and Leah being sisters, and you think about Rachel passing away, then one of the other three would have to, first of all, mother Benjamin, because Benjamin, Rachel passed away giving birth to Benjamin. So he never knew his mother. And so one of the other ladies had to take on the responsibility of mothering Benjamin. And thinking about which one it would be, it could have been Rachel's nurse that took on Benjamin with her sons as her responsibility, because when Rachel first learned that she couldn't have kids, she gave her nurse to her husband to have kids through her nurse for her husband. So they were considered her children. So since he was her child, it may have been her nurse, but it could just as well have been Leah or Leah's nurse as well. And I, you know, that just made me think about the dynamic of another mother raising Joseph's brother. Another mother other than his mother that he was able to see for at least one, two, or three years time passed. So that's an interesting twist in the facts that are not spelled out in the lesson. There are a lot of questions that we can pose about a text that we don't really get the answers to, but it can make us think, it can make us search, it can make us try to find out what's going on. In the background scripture, in the devotional scripture in Psalms, it says about the Lord tested Joseph's character. The Lord tested Joseph's character. How and in what ways can we think of that? We think if at from what we do know about Joseph's life and his relationship with family, that the Lord tested him. Could it be a test that for God to say, I'm going to give Joseph these dreams, but I really don't want him to share these dreams right now? Could that have been a test for Joseph to see if he would hold those dreams within himself or not, or if he would share those dreams? It could have been a test for Joseph to see that when he goes to visit his brothers and wears his coat, whether he should or should not wear the coat, since he knows that they're already jealous of him and thinks that their father favors him. There are always opportunities for us to look at situations and see how, especially like in today's time, how we can de-escalate situations. We may be in close proximity with family and friends, and tempers are running high and stuff now that we're in this COVID pandemic, and we may be just too close for comfort sometimes, and we have to look for opportunities to keep the peace. And whether that was a way that God was trying to test Joseph to see what his character was when he was dealing with his brothers. Because there's always two sides, three sides to every story, amen. But you know, it's the each person's side. And then they say it's the truth. So we know that Joseph wasn't perfect. We know that Joseph wasn't perfect. So there could always be opportunities for everybody involved to try to do a better job to keep the peace in the family. Bias love, showing favoritism, can cause great rifts in families. And if you personally have been the favorite child, or you personally have been a black sheep of the family, then you know the dynamics of that and how it can hurt and sometimes destroy a family. So, that is our lesson for today. This evening, Genesis 37, 2 through 11, 23 through 24a, and 28. These are the generations of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brethren, and the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and with the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought unto his father their evil report. Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children, because he was the son of his old age, and he made him a coat of many colors. And when his brethren saw that their father loved him more than all his brethren, they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him. And Joseph dreamed a dream, and he told it his brethren, and they hated him yet the more. And he said unto them, hear, I pray ye, this dream which I have dreamed. For behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and lo, my sheaves arose and also stood upright. And behold, your sheaves stood around about and made obeisance to my sheaf. And his brother said to him, shalt thou indeed reign over us? Or shalt thou indeed have dominion over us? And they hated him yet the more for his dreams and for his words. And he dreamed yet another dream, and told it his brethren, and said, behold, I have dreamed a dream more. And behold, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars made obeisance to me. and he told it to his father and his father's brethren and his brethren. And his father rebuked him and said unto him, What is this dream that thou hast dreamed? Shall I and thy mother and thy brethren indeed come to bow down ourselves to thee to the earth? And his brethren envied him, but his father observed the saying. And it came to pass, when Joseph was come unto his brethren, that they stripped Joseph out of his coat of many colors that was on him. And they took him and cast him into a pit. Then there passed by Midianite merchantmen, and they drew and lifted up Joseph out of the pit and sold Joseph to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver. And they brought Joseph to Egypt. That is our scripture for today. Our lesson is bias love. Thank you so much. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for this opportunity, God, to share your word with your children. God, we ask that you would just allow everything that has been said to be heard with your grace and the gifting of your spirit. We ask that you would allow every heart to receive what is meant to be received, and that they might discard all that is not meant for them, God. We thank you for all that you're yet doing in our lives. We ask your blessings upon us as we continue throughout this week. We ask for your strength, your grace, your mercy, your peace. We ask that you would forgive us of all our many sins, and that you would take us throughout the rest of this evening in peace and love. This is our prayer, God. We pray in Jesus' name. We give you glory and honor and praise. Amen. Amen. Have a great evening.